My name is Deanna Williamson. I'm the chair of the Department of Human Ecology, and I'm delighted to welcome you to the 2017 Empey Lecture. As some of you will know, this lecture is held in honor of Dr. Elizabeth Empey, who is the Dean of Home Economics at the University of Alberta from 1960 to 1976. Oops, I'm about to pull that out, sorry. The annual lecture series serves as a reminder of the very important work and the many contributions that Dr. Empey made to the university. And the annual lecture series also is an opportunity to highlight the work that we do in human ecology. And that, of course, might beg the question, what is that work that we do in human ecology? What is human ecology? Very simply, and I would add very importantly, human ecology is about exploring and enhancing everyday life. Today's lecture by Edward Hertzman, which will focus on how clothing moves from global factories to our closets, all at remarkably cheap prices, is without question a topic that is relevant to everyday life. It's a topic that has relevance not only in our everyday lives, as in you in me, but it's a topic that also has incredible relevance in the everyday lives of people around the world. This year, we're fortunate that the Office of Sustainability and the School of Retailing at the U of A have both co-sponsored the Empey Lecture, which I think is further evidence of the broad relevance of the topic that Mr. Hertzman will address today. And speaking of Mr. Hertzman, it's my pleasure to welcome him and introduce him. And given the nasty blizzard that New York had a few days ago, believe me, I am very pleased and incredibly relieved that he is actually here for me to introduce to you. Mr. Hertzman is a recognized sourcing and supply chain expert. His expertise stems from the work he did for more than a decade as an executive for major sourcing companies around the world. In this capacity, he partnered with globally recognized retailers and wholesalers, developing special expertise in key Asian countries that play a central role in apparel production. Mr. Hertzman writes about and consults with the global apparel industry in his role as founder and publisher of Sourcing Journal Online, a respected trade source for the textile and apparel industry. In his presentation today, Mr. Hertzman will offer insights into how the global apparel industry is being disrupted and the impacts on producers, retailers, and consumers. His presentation will challenge us to consider if and how apparel production can be ethical, profitable, and sustainable. And just a few details about the organization of our event, just want to let you know that there will be an opportunity for questions following the formal part of the presentation. As well, I hope that you'll be able to join us for some light refreshments that will be served just outside the lecture theater after the lecture finishes. But let's get on with the show. So without further ado, please join me in welcoming Edward Hertzman.
I'd like to thank everyone for inviting me here today. I want to apologize in advance if I'm a little off my A game. I seem to contract a rare Edmonton bug that us New Yorkers have not built an immunity to. So, but as it was said, if a nor'easter, a change of flight, a broken plane, a four-hour delay, and a misconnection wasn't going to hold me back, neither was a little stomach virus. So. You may just have to edit some things out of the video. So anyway. So there's a lot we're going to cover today, and some of it may be a little provocative to hear. You know, I'm in a unique seat, being a publisher of a publication, but also having worked for retailers, brands, sourcing companies, factories. I get to really see every side of the sourcing equation, and a lot of the things that I'm going to say today isn't very positive. But as an industry, we are I don't want to say under crisis, but there's a lot of change happening. And Unfortunately, all you have to do is read the news. You'll see that a lot of the traditional retailers are not adapting in order to survive. So a new era is upon us. This is the topic of today's presentation. And I just want to give you a little bit of background into the history of Sourcing Journal and why I started it. I'm not a publisher. I'm not a media guy by trade. I make a joke. It's only funny if you really know media and apparel that I know CM more than CPM. But what happened was I was, 25, 26 years old, and I'll never forget today. I was in the day I was in Bangladesh, and this was during the cotton crisis. Cotton every single day kept going up and up and up and up, and if you got a quote at 9 a.m. by noon, the order was not even valid. And I was sitting there with an executive of a multi-$100 million company, and he said, "You don't know what you're talking about. I have more years experience than you have years alive. The prices are going to come down. I don't accept the order." Well, the prices didn't come down. 2 days later, could I have the price you quoted me at 9? No. Can I have the price you quoted me at 12? No. So I decided that if people are not going to listen to me, well, there has to be an authority out there. People listen to the Wall Street Journal. This is before the fake news phenomenon, by the way. So I said, I'm going to start a sourcing journal. So I went back to New York, watched a YouTube video on how to build a WordPress site, and started aggregating links under fake names. I was Muhammad one day. I used every country other than an American. And people would say to me, "Oh, Eddie, you should really read the Sourcing Journal." "Oh, I haven't heard of it, but thank you." And little by little by little, it really started to pick up momentum to the point that I said, okay, Reuters is writing a great article about cotton prices going up, but what they're missing is the editorial slant that we need as executives is how does that affect your FOB? How does that affect your cost of goods? So I started hiring writers and producing proprietary content. Then I was at a crossroad. Now I had a really expensive hobby on my hand. So either the industry was going to embrace it and they were going to pay for it, or I was just going to go broke. So luckily today, we have 80,000 subscribers from almost every single brand in the world. We have a footwear publication called Vamp. We have a denim publication called Rivet. We do annual conferences in New York, an annual sourcing summit where top CEOs of Lee and Fung type of companies come and speak. So that just gives you a little bit of background as to how I fell into this. I still do quite a bit of work for the retail community. I say it's 20% of my income and 80% of my aggravation. And we'll get into why that's the case a little bit later in the presentation. But let's start by talking about the state of the industry today. What does it look like? And I also apologize that everything I kind of talk about from a retail perspective is really based on American retailers and stores, which I'm sure you guys know all of them anyway. So if we look at the industry today, this is today's landscape. Penney's is down 83%, Kohl's is down 59%, Macy's is down 46%, Nordstrom's is down, Sears is basically bankrupt, Target, Walmart, but Amazon is up 1,900%. Now this is just they say a picture says 1,000 words or paints 1,000. This is a lot about what's going on. So, I saw this slide, a while back, and I started publicly talking about how as if I was a hedge fund trader, I would short the entire industry. I believe there's going to be a massive implosion. I would short everybody, with the exception of 6 companies. TJ Maxx, which I think is winners for you guys, Ross, Burlington, Nike, Under Armour, and Adidas. And then I was lucky enough that the movie The Big Short came out. So then I started writing articles using that as a cultural reference, being, hey guys, I'm Matthew McConaughey. I think that was the role, right? Listen to me. Well, no one wanted to listen, but what would happen if they did listen? This is what would have happened. I would have outperformed every single hedge fund in the world. Because this represents, as of, a couple months ago, and actually things have gotten worse since then, I took 39 stocks, and 37 out of the 39 are down over 51%. A lot of them are bankrupt. Only 2 stocks were up, Target, which after its last report is now down, and Tilly's, which we'll consider a fluke. This, again, says a lot about the industry. It is losing massive amount of volume, and the ripple effect is seen not just in the department stores, it's seen throughout the entire supply chain. You got to remember, someone has to sew the garment, the fabric has to come from somewhere, the buttons have to come from somewhere. So just like during the financial crisis, so much talk about the auto industry, how it's the rivet supplier and the tire supplier, everyone gets taken down. There's a lot of casualties in this business that are not being discussed. So unfortunately, no one listened to me. The only stock I bought was PacSun. At a dollar, I said it's going to go to 0 or 5. It went to 0. I lost all my money, so I'm not going into the hedge fund world. But my theory was right. So You know, I make a joke and I say that I used to be able to plan these presentations out, you know, 2-3 weeks in advance, but you almost have to wait to the morning of. Because you wake up and every single day there's another piece of news that is like, oh my God, someone else is filing bankruptcy, someone else is laying off, or you don't know, Trump could, you know, issue a ban on imports. So basically, I'm updating this as of last night. These are just some of the things that have happened in 2017. Macy's closing 63 doors, firing 10,000 people. Kohl's business is down. JCPenney's to close 140 doors and sell their home office. Sears, I don't even want to talk about Sears. They are on a life support. Limited went bankrupt. Wet Seals went bankrupt for a second time. MC Sports filed Chapter 11. Eastern Outfitters, parent company of Bob Stores and Eastern Mountain Sports, they filed bankruptcy. BCGB, walking in the mall today, 70, 60, 80% off. Why? Because they're closing. Gildan bought American Apparel and is closing all the stores. Li & Fung, I don't know how familiar everyone is, but Li & Fung is the largest sourcing company in the world. They were just delisted from the Hong Kong Stock Exchange. That is very significant. And that's very significant because the Hong Kong Stock Exchange does not want this company to represent the Hong Kong economy. So it's limited to a certain amount of companies. But Li & Fung has been a monster in the sourcing arena. There's no one larger than them. They're a multi-billion dollar company, and they're getting killed. Because again, who's their largest customer? Kohl's. Well, if Kohl's goes down, their volume goes down. Who makes 60% of Restoration Hardware's furniture? Li & Fung. Well, Restoration Hardware had a couple really bad years, so their orders go down. It's just a lot of bad news. Jack Threads, I don't know if you guys are familiar with that site. It was, Thrillist bought it. I used to do a lot of business with them. All of a sudden, one day you call them, the phone stops ringing, they're done. Gordman's, I think this happened yesterday or 2 days ago, they just filed bankruptcy. And last year, PacSun filed bankruptcy, Aeropostale, Sports Authority, Golfsmith, BHS, all bankrupt. And this is just the first quarter. I think it's only going to get worse, and I don't mean that to scare people, but I just think this is a reality. So, I'm just trying to see what slide is next. One of the solutions that brands and retailers have had to kind of fight their woes is just source cheaper. If we get the FOB cheaper and we can sell the goods cheaper, we'll be better off. But that's not really working. And it's not sustainable on so many levels. If you look at this slide, you got Primark selling a jean for $7. Here's a dollar t-shirt. Look at these shorts, $14.99, $12. If you go to a factory and you look at open costing, and you start to really look at the cost of the fabric, you look at the cost of the trims, you look at the cost of the labor, all the bells and whistles, these products can't be made at this price. Not possible. Now, is there some cheating going on? Is there under invoicing happening? Is there hanky panky? Are people selling off inventory at losses to keep their? So many things are happening. You think Primark is profitably selling a $7 pair of jeans? No, it's a loss leader for them. I could make the jean for $4.50, $4.60, get it in the store, sell it at $7. It's a break even. But you know what? Hopefully, while you're there, you'll buy something else which has a higher margin. But it's destroying the traditional retailers like a Macy's, a Penny's, and whatnot. And I have a question, and I started out by saying the three of the six stocks, which I would never touch, is the off-price because they have done so well, is I'm actually worried about them. How can they keep getting cheaper and cheaper product? One of the reasons I say this industry is 20% of my income and 80% of my aggravation, 2015 I made a short for $14.99, sold for $14.99. $16.99. Then it went to $14.99. Then it went to $12.99. How could I keep reducing costs? And you want to talk about compliance and sustainability and ethics, let's not even go there. Forget it. What you have to do to hit these prices, I don't want to put on the record. Okay, but people are doing it. And these make up thousands and thousands of thousands of stores that people shop in. Not the 25 Bloomingdale's that we buy our J brands from. It's a really small, slice of the retail pie. So, one of the things we talk about, promotional holiday push pressure, this is from an article we wrote. Merchants have relied this year more heavily on price promotion to drive store and website traffic than last. Despite better balanced inventory than last year, well-documented and costly overstocks, apparel retailers have seen their average selling price head in the wrong direction over the holidays. Retailers can expect further price declines in the next couple of months. There's something very interesting here. If you speak to someone that's been in this business for 30 years, I haven't, but if you find someone, they're going to tell you that when they made, you know, a Henley from an Banana Republic 20 years ago, they paid more money for the Henley then than they do now. Same thing for a jean. We are one of the only businesses that have been on a straight deflationary model. Every year, the cost of goods get cheaper and cheaper and cheaper at retail. How is that sustainable? And then we start to talk about how are we going to improve the quality of lives at the factory level? How are we going to improve compliance? How do we give workable wages to people here in Canada or in the States? Everyone involved. It's a great question, but no one wants to really talk about it. Just put things on sale because you got to move inventory, inventory, inventory. So where is the business going? Like I said, a lot of the business is going to TJ Maxx, Ross, Burlington, Saks, and Nordstrom Rack. I was just given an article today that showed that Saks Off 5th is opening more stores in Canada. Nordstrom Rack is opening more stores in Canada. We wrote an article that said, is Nordstrom Rack the new off-price, you know, new off-pricer? They got really mad at us. Because the reality is there's more racks than there are traditional Nordstrom stores. So what's driving their growth, if any, is the off-price model. Now online, you know, a lot of businesses going online. You're a Fairfetch or a Shopop. These companies are doing very well. Now, are they making up the volume of the traditional brick and mortar? No, but there's clearly this is where a lot of business is going. Then you also have the fast fashion players, the Inditex, which is Zara and Bull & Bear and Bershka. You know, that man is the second wealthiest man in the world. And we're going to get into the, you know, talk about Zara as a business a little bit later. And then we have the clubs. I don't know if you guys have them here, the Costco, the Sam's. Their model is different. You pay a membership, but they'll sell things for very, very low margin. So again, it's a different model. But what you're seeing here is you don't see the traditional brick and mortar retailers that we once, you know, championed as, you know, the icons of the industry. You know, when Ralph Lauren started having problems, I was like, oh, we're all susceptible. And Macy's has problems. We're all susceptible to really, you know, to a lot of change. So I gave a speech in January. I was asked by a $350 million sourcing company to come out to their board meeting and speak for an hour on the American market. And they basically want to know is how come they couldn't get more and more business in America. And I said, well, guys, you're chasing Sears. You're chasing the Gap. I wouldn't even take that business. And I put this slide up there as a trick. There were people there from China, Bangladesh, Pakistan, India, Thailand, of course, and maybe Vietnam. And I said, how many of these brands do you guys know? And they go, I don't know any of them. I said, aha, that's why you paid me to come out here. I am not saying that these represent the fix of the future, but these are taking market share from a lot of traditional players. You know, and they're also, the VC community and the private equity community is putting a lot of money behind these box services, subscription services, you know. And so what you're seeing is what I call, I think in the future, the few and the new. I think what you're going to see is a few retailers and brands that have huge, deep pockets that are able to survive and invest in the future. And then the aggregate of all these smaller players are going to come together to make up the volume of the traditional retailers. So do I think that DSLTD, which sells, you know, a $100 jean instead of the same premium jean at $200, is that the future? No, but if I buy one pair, that's one less pair of J brand. And if you buy one less pair, that's one less pair of frame. That's one less trip to Nordstrom's. That's one less click on their website. Add that up company by company by company by company. And it's a substantial loss for the traditional players. And then look, you have people like Trunk Club that got sold for $350 million to Nordstrom, only for them this past year to write off $200 million of it. So I'm not saying that all these are the answers, but there is a lot of change happening, and these type of businesses cannot be ignored. So we talked about the few and the new. So what do I think, you know, it's interesting, in retail, you could track so many things. You could track weather. You could track mall traffic. You could track comps. You know, you could track so many different things. But how do you know if someone is sourcing properly? Or how do you know if someone is a good sourcer? There's no metric. Wall Street can't get and say, oh, this company has a 4.5 out of 7 rating. You don't know. And so much of one's business, so much of one's cost of goods, or cost is cost of goods. And I can tell you from personal experience how disheartened I've been so many times at large organizations that you watch them throwing away tons and tons of money because of inefficiency, overprocessed, supply chains. So, let's get into that a little bit. And I don't want to get into the micro of this, because some of it is really, if Macy's was sitting here, I would critique them. But one of the things that you'll see with a lot of traditional retailers is they'll have an office in Hong Kong, or they'll have an office in Shanghai, and they'll put all their business through that office. So they're basically the gatekeeper for all the other countries where they source. So someone like me knocks on the door and says, look, I have an alternative. I have a solution. What's the first thing they do? Work with my Hong Kong office. I politely say, if that is your strategy, I better off not even get started. Because that Hong Kong company does not want to be made look, they don't want to look bad. So if I go there and could source it cheaper, if I could source it quicker, if I have a solution that they haven't brought to the table, I make them look bad. So they do everything in their power to get me out of the way. So you don't even have healthy competition in your supply chain. Now, there's a lot of hanky-panky that goes on. People get paid under the table, and less and less of this is happening, kickbacks from factories. But this is still a very archaic business, and a lot happens in developing countries that are often not talked about in the classroom or even in the office. But we know what's happening. Some of these things, again, I don't know how detailed we should get into, but overpaying for nominated suppliers. I don't know if everyone knows what that means. A nominated supplier is, so let's say I'm a brand, I want to make sure that every trim I have is identical. So instead of allowing a factory to replicate it themselves, you go to a third party like an Avery Dennison or a YKK, and they'll mass produce, and then they'll send it to each factory so that every single patch or every single zipper is identical. If you rely on every single factory to make their own version of it, you'll have 18 different patches. The name Levi won't even be L-E-V-I by the end of it. So this is supposed to be a quality control process. There should be economies of scale involved in this if you're buying such bulk. But you don't often see this. You see now when people are looking for speed. So let's say I have a factory in Peru that could turn orders in 2 weeks. And I call Avery Dennison in Hong Kong and say, I need the trims. And they say, oh, it's going to take 2 months. Whoa. Guys, there's something off there. Duty is something else. You can't not pay duty. If you're luckily for Canada, if you source from Bangladesh, it's duty free. But duty is anywhere from 17% to 33%, depending if you're a cotton rich product or a synthetic rich product. So one of the things, I was at a major sporting goods retailer, and I was asking them about do they do factory audits? Do they do compliance checks? Do they want a third party to come in and inspect? Yes, yes, yes to everything. And I said to them, if the factory pays for all this, they're going to lump it onto the cost of goods, and then you're going to pay duty on top of that. So I said, let's make it very simple. Let's take all those costs out, give you a separate invoice, pay that, and you won't pay duty. Why pay 20% duty on a test? Oh, we don't have a budget for that. But what? I don't have a budget for that. Yeah, that's not how we operate. I said, guys, you're paying for it. Why overpaying? Sorry, that's not how we work. So you're probably sitting here saying, this is such common sense. And I hit my head against the wall when I work with these companies because they just don't get it. And they wonder why. I could go on and give you 100 examples of things that are even more insane than that. And you wonder why people are going out of business. I'm sitting there at a teen retailer showing them a piece of fleece from Pakistan for $9, and the same one they make at Vietnam for $12. Do the math. How much of a savings is that? You know why they dropped me as a vendor? Because I was, 2 weeks late. I said, who cares? Who cares? You have the time. Build it into your supply chain. Yes, it's more difficult to work in Pakistan. You think the venture capital company that just bought them out of bankruptcy would like that $2 or $3 per piece times millions of units for years in the bank? Why? Because people didn't want to, there was no incentive for them. Why should they work harder? Why should they struggle? Well, they work so hard, they work themselves out of jobs. So another thing that flaw that I see a lot of companies do is they jump factory to factory to factory. Today more than ever, a factory, and the dynamics of power changes. It used to be the buyer was king. You hear stories back in the day that you would go to the Radisson and DACA and the factories would line up and you'd be able to say, dollar, 98, 97, 96, go away, 95, 94, Then the dynamics started to shift that the factory was king. They had the capacity. We all, you know, if you're a grade A factory that has all the necessary compliance, they don't want to deal with this bullshit. So they started turning away orders. So there's this power struggle. Right now what's happening is because business is very depressed, people are abusing the factories. Wall Street says, oh, if the factories are idle, that's great. We could get things cheaper. Yes, if you want to think like that. But if we want to think as a society, what you're basically saying is the workers, how are you going to pay the workers the wages that they've been promised every year? How are you going to improve the facilities, whether it's water treatment facilities or, better healthcare or, meals or nurses on staff? Where does that come from? It's not free. And one of the biggest problems with compliance is, if you want to do business with Walmart, they'll come to your factory and say, in order to do business with us, you need to be Walmart compliant. And they're going to tell you everything they need. And then as a factory, you're going to have to make a decision if you want to invest maybe hundreds of thousands of dollars to make these changes. There's no promise of an order. So you go through all that work, and all of a sudden, they say, you know what? Our penetration in Bangladesh is a little too high right now. We're going to pass. Whoa, I just did all this work for you. So it's a partnership when they're making money, and it's you're on your own when things are bad. And this is what we see time and time again. Jumping factory to factory to factory over a nickel is not a sourcing strategy. And this has been the practice that's been used by so many retailers and brands. Just get the cheapest price at all costs. But we see all hell has broken loose with that philosophy. So one retailer that does it different and is like the poster child of the industry is Zara. And a lot of people, and I tell you, I'm so sick of talking about Zara. Because I've did lectures on Zara, I've held conferences on Zara, I made a lot of money teaching people about Zara. Doesn't matter how many times you tell someone something, they don't get it. You know what the single biggest advantage Zara has over everyone else? Anyone want to guess? No. All right, you're in the wrong lecture hall. Piracy is, I think, downstairs. In the back. You give me all of the you're reading my slides. Culture. What they beat everyone on is culture. Okay? The way they work, the way they empower their employees to make decisions is different. If you study anything on Zara and their model, the word culture comes up over and over again. Any one of us could go to a factory and buy X number of yards of Grey Goose and book the lines and say, replenish quicker. Okay, we don't do that. Why don't we do that? It's not part of our culture. What they do is, I'm always very impressed, and I worked for a company that did, I don't know, $100, $150 million in Zara business, which is actually nothing if you look at their total volume. But that's a lot of $2 t-shirts if you think about it. The workers would get on a plane, go to the factories, sit there, I don't like this wash, can you change this, can you do this, I'll be back tomorrow. They go back tomorrow, boom, 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 they place the order on the spot. You know how we do it in America? You send a tech pack, you wait for a sample, then the sample gets DHL'd back, you make your comments. Too blue. What the hell is too blue? Someone thinks it's a Pantone number. You know, make it darker. You think some guy in a lab in Delhi knows what darker means? No disrespect to anyone from Delhi. I don't know what darker means. How does someone decipher that? Then they get a lab dip resubmitted. Oh no, we've decided we want to do a change. We now don't want blue, we want green. Resubmit the whole thing. By the time you get the product on the floor, Zara had it, sold out of it, and is on to the next. Because they work on a very different timeline. The majority of their stuff is near sourced. I'm going to Portugal in a week. And I'm meeting with some factories that do a substantial amount of business for them. So Portugal, Morocco, Tunisia. What does that allow them to do? One of the things that Zara is known for that other retailers are not known for is marking down their goods substantially less. So if you mark down your goods 40%, and they marked it down 20%. That's huge. Even if they pay a little bit more per garment, the total profit at the end of the season is substantially more. Again, culture. You don't think like that in America. What's the cheapest price? Now, what is the cheapest overall price? So what do? They'll buy very, very narrow. They'll buy a lot of styles across multiple, you know, many SKUs. They'll buy very little of it. And if it works, they're able to replenish back into it very quickly. If it doesn't work, their inventory liability is so low, it's okay. We made a mistake. Move on. It's the culture of how they're trained. It's okay to make mistakes. Keep chasing the fashion. You know they don't even have a standard size? That's why you go to Zara, everything, I'm a medium, I'm extra large, double extra large, small. But who cares? You go and you try it on. It's how they run their business. And then they program things out a little bit differently. So yes, they do stuff in Bangladesh. And that is a long lead time. But they're making maybe a coarse sweater, a 12-gauge sweater in, you know, navy, black, heather gray. And they'll wait for it. And they'll make it on off-peak seasons because they'll take the risk. Because they're not waiting for the market to tell them what's hot. They're telling the market what's hot and their ability to react. And their employees are out there on the ground. They're making the decisions there. You know what an American thinks a business trip is? Going to Hong Kong, going to the Shangri-La and eating, you know, dim sum. Well, I went to my office. I was very tired. That's not a business trip. Go to the fact, you'll be surprised if you actually work with them how much quicker you can get. But here's the problem, even if you do that, well, I can't place the order until I get back to New York, and I got to show it to the buyer and the planner and the merchandiser and then the senior buyer. She's out on maternity leave, and then this person, and then that person. And guys, colored denim was like 3 years ago. Move on. You know, it's like, this is, you hit your head against the wall. Make a freaking decision. What's the big deal? But I'm telling you, it's, you're all still, most of you are still young enough to get out while you can, but this is what's happening. So, you know, we talked about quick turn, little reliance on inventory, multiple SKUs, less markdown, culture based on empowerment, new product in the stores each week. That is their experience. This is a word we keep hearing. We need in-store experience. That doesn't mean you have a freaking roller coaster inside of Macy's. An experience is that if you go to Zara tonight and like that blouse, someone wearing a blouse, that blouse, if you don't buy it tonight, next week it's not going to be there. They've created a sense of urgency. That's what the off-price model has done. It's a treasure hunt. I got to buy it now. When I go to Macy's or you go to Hudson Bay or whatever your equivalent is, you go in there and you see 87 of the same shirts. Nah, I'll come back next week. I'll wait for it to go on sale. What's the sense of urgency? So also, if you go back to the earlier slide, you know, Trunk Club, well, I can't tell you if it's a profitable or non-profitable venture. Writing off $200 million doesn't speak volumes about their ability to run the company, but it's an experience. Every month you get the box. So look at Bonobos. Bonobos is a very interesting model about how people are changing a little bit. Started out as a pure play e-com retailer. And Andy Dunn was very lucky because he got money and raised money, I think, based on a tech valuation, not on apparel valuation. I think people have wised up a little bit that ultimately Bonobos is selling clothes. They're not, you know, Instagram, but whatever. He raised a lot of money. But then what you start to realize is people think that selling stuff online is cheaper. Oh, I don't have physical inventory. I don't have to worry about real estate. But you don't realize it's actually not that much cheaper. And in fact, a lot of companies lose more money online than they do with anything else. So you look, we've trained consumers today where you will go to Zappos.com, you buy 10 pairs of shoes, you return 9 of them. That's not free. So if I start EddieShoes.com, I got to compete with the same customer service. Where does that money come from? So going back to Bonobos, how do you reduce returns? How do you improve customer experience? How do you make people differentiate yourself versus every other little website out there selling a chino pant? Well, they started opening these little showrooms. Now, these showrooms could be 1,200 square feet. That's a far cry from 10 or 20,000. And what do they have in that store? Nothing but a few samples. There's no inventory. And here's the thing. I make an appointment. Well, granted, I never bought anything from Bonobos, but that's not the point. You make an appointment, and you have a stylist work with you. So all of a sudden, I'm not a 40. I'm a 42 in this jacket, and I'm a large and not a medium. And I pick out everything I want, and then I make the order, and they get shipped to me. They just reduce their returns, because maybe I thought I was a medium. I didn't think I was a large. oh, wow, that was really cool. I went there, they gave me a drink, this guy walked me around the store, or this woman walked me around the store, she told me I look really good, my tush looked good in these pants, I gotta buy it. Okay, whatever it takes to sell, you know, a chino today, but it's part of an experience. I don't get that when you go to Sears. You'd be dead on the floor, they wouldn't even... No one would, no, forget it, don't even walk in there. It's scary. The security will find you 2 days later. It's you laugh, but it's true. It's true. And Eddie Lambert, all he keeps doing is selling real estate and, I don't know, playing with his own money, but God bless him. So there's something that, I don't know, you take a picture of this, maybe you'll get sent the presentation. There's a lot of confusion between fast fashion and speed to market. So I do a lot of consulting for the Wall Street community, and they'll say, oh, Eddie, just got off the phone with the Gap. Great news, they're going to be fast fashion players. I go, no, they are not. They're not going to be fast fashion. Do you even understand what that means? All they're saying is they're doing fabric platforming. They're going to take a little bit of risk on the fabric up front so they can replenish quicker. That's called speed to market. Also, they're not the next H&M? No. Neither should they be. But there's a lot of differences in this. And people are constantly misusing these terms. I don't want to go through everyone because we don't have all that time. But the one major difference here is that in fast fashion, the primary emphasis is speed, with fashion and quality second. Like I said, H&M Zara doesn't have a standard fit. They want fashion every week, new fashion in the store. Speed to market. Speed is important, but secondary, getting the price, the product right. Most of the traditional retailers out there need to improve their speed to market strategies. And if they do this, they will have, you know, less reliance on inventory, more SKUs, they'll have less markdowns. So really, not everyone could be Zara. Not everyone should be Zara. But there are things that you could do today. How do you take a 40 to 50 week cycle and turn it into 20 or 30? It sounds so simple. And these consulting firms are out there making a fortune telling people what to do. They can't do it. And the reason we know they can't do it is because of this. So I'm not like some prophet, you know, telling you I'm going to part the Red Sea here. I mean, you see it. This is a disaster. So, like I said, enough with Zara. We all know their model. And in case you didn't realize, Ortega, the man that started this, is the second wealthiest man in the world. And I want you to realize, they're not the best with technology. They don't have any sophisticated advertising. They don't necessarily have the greatest product. You know, what is it about them that makes them different? There's nothing that, they're not investing in beacons and magic mirrors and drones coming to your house. No one's telling me in that store my tush looks good. But you know what? They're killing everybody. And I think a lot of it is because of the culture. And every other thing that everyone said here is true. But it all starts with the culture and how they set up their organization. So what should you do today? If I was if I was consulting for a retailer, what are some of the things that I think people need to do? One is, I think you have to source closer to home. And that's different for where you are in the world. So again, I met with an organization. Guy does $75 million a year, and he makes for Vince, and he makes for Varvatos, and Michael Kors. And I said, that's very impressive, but that's not my reality. I got to ship at Costco. I got to ship, you know, TJ Maxx. He goes, you know who my largest client is? TJ Maxx. I go, what? He's got a warehouse sitting there in Peru with all the yarn. Every week they give him a new order. And every 15 days he's shipping stuff to them. And they're selling that shirt for $9.99. And it's the same exact shirt that you could buy from Vince for $100. You know the differences? Instead of having a $2 trim here or a fancy label, you take that off. Or Costco, it says Kirkland. Whoa, so it's possible to make the product in Peru? Yes, because it's win-win for him, it's win-win for TJ Maxx. So he works on a little bit less margin, but he has so much volume. But he has the commitment. Again, it's a commitment from the retailer and the factory that we're going to do this together. Not waiting every week for a tech pack or waiting for an order. Every week he gets the order, and he has a huge liability on his hand. He has a warehouse stocked with fabrics that they've committed to. But he's willing to make the commitment because the relationship has been so successful. So I think we have to start exploring. This doesn't necessarily mean you're going to start making goods in America or making goods in Canada. But how could we turn the lead time down? How do I stop chasing the $1.80 shirt out of Bangladesh and maybe think the $2.70 shirt out of Haiti isn't more expensive if you listen to some of the stuff I said before. So again, I think you need to have small units, more SKUs, faster turnaround. You know, the old traditional manufacturing model is I want 100,000 pieces of a flat front short because efficiency is, it's about the line. The more you make of the same product in the line, the quicker the workers get, the more input or output you get. That's how factories make money. But it's changing. If the factories are not willing to adapt to this new culture and this new way of doing business, they won't have anything to make. So there's also lessons that have to happen in the front end and the back end. Now, reducing inventory levels and replenishing quicker. Here's another thing. Utilizing big data to really know your customer and determine product buys. I was in a conference in D.C. last week, and you know, I'm a generalist in a lot of this stuff. This guy got up there, and you would probably never open your computer again if you knew how much information these brands, they know the computer, this artificial intelligence, knows what you should buy more than you know what you should buy. They know what book you should buy. They know where you should. I tell you, I've stopped reading Business Insider because I can't go to sleep at night. I open the screen, it says 10 ways to make $1 million, 10 books to read to make $1 million, 10 smoothies to have to be a millionaire, the car to drive to become a millionaire. Oh, next, 5 quotes from millionaires. I guarantee if you go there right now, it's not going to say that. It's going to be talking about privacy, piracy, or whatever. So it's data mining. It's understanding your customers. And today, companies, they like to use big terms and, well, we have all this information, but are you actively using it? How do you, when someone buys something, how does that information get translated back to the supply chain to know what color to dye that fabric? So, you know, and also when you go to the sites and you have these, you know, online conversations, a lot of times you're not speaking to humans. These are robots who actually probably have better English than most of us, you know, that speak English. Then there's things like customization. And this is a big topic. A lot of people want to get into the customization business. And what does that mean? You know, here you go to Nike.com, you can make your shoe, or you go to Louis and you can put your name on the bag. I think that's pretty tacky, but you know, whatever you want. People want everything to be unique. So now people have to change their supply chain. How do you account for this? What do I think is going to happen? And this is my best guess, is I think you're going to see a factory open in Detroit where Nike ships all this product, the uppers and the soles and the shoelaces, and then based on what you want, they'll put it together there. Now what that does is that's a huge reduction in inventory liability. They're not waiting for Eddie to go into the Nike Town store and see if he wants black with blue. They're making it based on what I want on the spot. And there's enough data out there to support that if they make 1 million black soles and 10 million white shoelaces, some permutation or combination, it will get used up. There's these new distribution channels and new in-store experiences. So, you know, we talked about the showroom concept. How many people are familiar with beacon technology? Okay, so I'm going to say it's a shy group, so we'll assume everyone. Again, you walk into a store, you have this information on your phone, and all of a sudden it's telling you here, let's say 20% off your jeans and shirt. It knows that you want to go and buy this product. It's directing you to exactly what you should buy based on the data it has on you. What human's going to do that? Ah, you look good in brown. Maybe I should show you this brown jacket. No. And you know what? This is a reason to get out of your house and go to the store because it's a different experience. Look at this magic mirror. This is something that, you know, very few people have been able to figure out. How do you see your behind from the front? What a great idea. The key for every jean, especially if you're a woman, is how it fits the derriere, right? That is that French for tush, right? You can't see it in a traditional mirror. So go to the store, all of a sudden Diesel flips it around and, oh, that's really cool. Enhances the customer experience. Then you got these other things. I was in Hong Kong, actually at Lian Feng's office, and they showed me this new technology. You stand in front of the mirror, and all of a sudden I hit a button, and they're going to put a new suit on me. I change it. All of a sudden a new tie's on me, all on the screen. So I don't need to, it's bringing me product based on what they think I want. And I'm like, ah, shit, that tie's really cool. Then you could go ask the person, or there's another probably app or robot that's going to, a drone will come and bring it to you. But They're not waiting for me to find it. They're bringing it to me. Now, again, the problem is this is not the future. This is the now. And so many companies are so far behind. The consumers are so much smarter than the brands that this is what's causing all these problems. All right, what do we have? Okay, last thing we'll talk about is Donald Trump. Presidential cycle. Okay, what does it mean? So I was in Washington. I have a lot of friends that are on the Hill, a lot of lobbyist groups, and this is the one answer that everyone has. No one knows. No one knows what the hell is going to happen. But the thing that is scaring people the most is this border tax. And I don't know if everyone knows what the border tax is, but I'll make it very simple math. Right now, you're able to write off your cost of goods. So if you have a $10 sale and the product costs $6 and you have $3 overhead, staff, whatever, and you make $1 profit based on the current tax code in America, let's say you pay 35% tax. So you would pay 35-cent tax on that garment. It's not even Donald Trump that wants this. It's Paul Ryan in the House that are behind this because they also have to pay for all these new initiatives they want to do. So we're going to become the sacrificial cattle. I actually do not think they're thinking about the apparel industry and how detrimental it is to us as a whole. But their new idea is, let's lower the corporate tax to 20%. Great. But now you can't write off the cost of goods. So now your tax bill goes from 35 cents to $1.40. Well, if my profit's $1 and my tax bill is $1.40, again, I only have an undergraduate degree in economics, but this to me shows you that you are bankrupt. Which we can go back to the first slide. So what do you do? Now you got all these politicians, you got all these consultants, everyone's trying to figure this out. All they got to do is read my slide and realize that it's a horrible idea. The idea is that go out of business, second option, raise prices. How do you raise prices? I just told you every season the prices are going down. No, people will pay more. Or the third option is make things in America. Let me tell you about my philosophy on making things in America. You out of your mind, okay? Number one, who wants their child to become a seamstress? And I don't mean that in a derogatory way. But let's say that wasn't an issue. Let's say the average person in North Carolina makes $15 or $16 an hour. In one day, that person will make more than the monthly salary of someone in Bangladesh. Now, you tell me how that's sustainable. But let's say money doesn't matter. We pay the price. Where are they working? We don't have the factories. But let's say, I have a wish and boom, the factories all pop up. Where's all the raw materials coming from? We have cotton and whatnot, but we're not sitting there with all these synthetic fibers that are being produced in Korea and Taiwan. So you add up all these variables and you say to yourself, how is that even possible? Now, if you're a jean brand and you want to have a small $10, $15, $20 million company and you want to make it in LA and you want to sell it for $200 to $250 to, Barney's or online or, little boutiques, you could have a small business doing that. But to think that Walmart, or just look at the volume. It's like 97 or 98% of the goods that we buy apparel is imported. How can we make up that numbers in America? Where the hell is it going to, where are we going to make it? So, and then what no one else talks about, which bothers me, is we talk about human rights, we talk about everything. You'll take a country like Bangladesh where nearly 100%, it's 90 plus percent of their exports are ready-made garments. If you wipe them out, you're going to kill a country. There is no other jobs. That's all they have. So what about humanity as a whole? Do we only care about bringing jobs back to Detroit, or do we care about killing millions of people? There's literally nothing there. How many people have been to Bangladesh? Okay. It's a lovely place. I take Cipro one out of every three times I go there. So the other thing right now is we're concerned is Trump going to put a tax on China? Is Trump going to put a tax on Mexico? We don't really know, but the advice that I'm giving people is the best strategy you could have is a diversified supply chain. You have to mitigate your risk. So if you have everything in China and he wakes up one day and issues a tweet, no more China, you're in trouble. So if you do a little bit in China, a little bit in Vietnam, you do something in Mexico, you do something here or there, and again, you do it based on product. Each country has a different... People say, oh, what's the best country to work in? That's a stupid question. Like, if I want Italian food, I go to an Italian restaurant. I don't go to the Italian restaurant and order a burrito. Why? Because they're cheaper? They don't make the product. So this is how you have to look at countries. Each country has different raw materials, if any. Different countries have different duty preferences. Some of them have free trade agreements. Some of them have closer proximity to home. Some of them have different skill sets. Are men on the machines or women? I know that's a very sexist thing, but women's hands are much different than men's hands. Okay, I'm not going to get into any more detail there. But you'll see that in Pakistan, it's a lot of men because it's a coarser yarn, and they make fleece, and they make denim, so there's more men. You go to Vietnam, and they're doing more, technical garments, or northern India, it's mostly women. They have more finesse. So this is the last slide that I really have is, people ask me, so what's going to happen? And my gut feeling is, well, if we're waiting for the traditional, you know, the Macy's or the Penney's or the Sears to change, you got to be crazy. Because everything you learn, or, you know, I'm a big believer in reading, and if you read about other industries, that's the only way, you got to read about other industries and apply it to the industry you're in. And if you look at this, iTunes disrupted the music industry. But iTunes was not started by Sony. Tower Records didn't come up with this idea. Netflix, again, it wasn't Cablevision that said, oh, or Time Warner, I had this brilliant idea. Same thing with Uber. The taxi commission didn't come together and say, we have a new business model. And Airbnb, the Hiltons didn't come up with that. It's people out there that probably don't even know what the hell they're doing, have such a great idea that say, I'm just going to go for it. Like people say to me, why did you get into publishing? If I actually knew the cost of publishing and all the agony and heartache I would deal with on a day-to-day, I would never go into that. But these guys, like great entrepreneurs, you just do it. And I think that's what we need, some of that entrepreneurial mentality to start changing this industry. So I leave you with this. Are you the cassette, the DVD, or the iTunes song? All right. So is there any questions? Okay.
Where does the luxury brand market fit into all this? Because there seems to be a very large focus on things that I've been reading, business and fashion and areas like that, where there's so much focus on the luxury brands. And from a consumer perspective, they are so expensive. They're out of reach for the majority of people, and it seems like it's a huge business. So how does that fit in?
So I think there's, when you talk about luxury, you got to talk about real luxury, which is Chanel and Hermes and that type of stuff. And then you have aspirational luxury, which is the Kate Spade and the Michael Kors and all that. The truly, truly high end of the market, it's not really impacted by this that much because there's still enough wealth out there that's going to go spend $15,000 on a Birkin bag. There's never a sale at Hermes, buy one Birkin, get one free. Oh, you know? And I say, it's interesting. Look at every other industry. It's like, you know, Father's Day, buy a Maxima and get an Ultima 50% off. Like, you don't hear these things. So I think the luxury market, those few customers, a few brands, are immune to a lot of this. But I'll also tell you, when they changed the laws in Hong Kong, and again, I'm not an expert on this, a lot of the growth came from the Asian markets. And a lot of people were coming from the rural areas to Hong Kong to buy. And they changed the tax code or their ability to, the Hong Kong market tanked. Look at the luxury watch market. It's really struggling right now because people want either, they don't want to spend money on watches or they're trying to find, you know, digital alternatives or whatever it is. So I think for those brands, the key is keeping your identity and not giving into the temptation of never-ending growth. You know, this is something that I didn't bring up. Never-ending growth in Wall Street, I think, is what's killed this industry. I mean, I stopped growing at 6 feet tall. You know, why can't I keep going? At some point, it's you know. So you look at, I use this example. You look at American Apparel. American Apparel was a great concept. Made in America, questionable. Fair wages, questionable. But made in America, $50 t-shirt. I go down to the West Village. I try it on. Oh, I love the cotton poly blend. It's a slim fit. You know what? I could afford to buy it. Thank God, I buy it. All of a sudden, next to every Dwayne Reed, there's an American Apparel. In every city in America, there's 100 American Apparel. Can't support that. Take the 10 largest cities in the country, put two or three stores in there. If they had 100 stores total, they'd probably still be around and being doing very well. Wall Street needs you to keep comping, and they need you to keep growing. So people like Ralph and people like Coach, who, I don't know if you want to call them luxury, what do? They Coach sells more stuff in the outlets than they do in their regular stores. They cannibalize their brand. Most of Ralph's business is from TJ Maxx growth and the outlets. So again, I can't tell you if Tiffany or Chanel is going to be around forever. But the one thing these guys do that no one else does is they stay true to their brand, and you never see them discount. and they only cater to that. And that's why it's all about people aspire to have that. And they make a lot of money in Chanel perfume. Well, maybe you can't afford a $5,000 pocketbook, but everyone has $100 to go buy their Chanel number 5. You know, or you go to these stores. I got the Ferragamo keychain. Maybe I can't afford the $600 shoes, but I have the Ferragamo. You know, you buy into the brand. So I don't really think that answered your question at all, but next. That are commercially available where? So one thing that's happening is when you go to China now more than ever, you see more and more of the factories catering to the local market. So one, I think that affects capacity, that affects pricing, and the Chinese desire to manufacture US brands. I think the other thing is as the local brands become more relevant and more money is put into it and more advertising is put into that, there's a less of a dependency on the Westerner brands. Now, I think there will always be an allure for the international companies. You know, that's why you go to Hong Kong, it's like Disneyland. Like, how do you have a Chanel on every corner? Who are these people that are spending this money? I mean, it's like unbelievable. There's like more Chanels than there is Starbucks. It's like, yeah, let me get a latte and a $6,000 bag. I bought one of those in the past and I'll never do that again, but that's another story. I don't know, but I also think you'll see some of those brands come here. But I think I look at things from the supply chain perspective. And that's really where I'm best, I can answer that from my best position is that I notice now factories are not as desperate to do American production because they have the local brands filling their capacity. And if you're not desperate and people are paying more money and they can work locally in their own language, in their own community, and you don't have to rely on the shiesty Americans that want everything 10 cents cheaper and then screw you because you're 2 weeks late, that's where I see a big shift happening. A question? Yeah.
So for a sustainable company to be profitable, obviously if Zara is making a shirt at like $2 per piece and you want an ethical shirt that's made like properly, like within, I guess, like North American standards, it's going to cost you way more. How do you brand that, or how do you sell that when you have Zara or all those competitors that are paying like pennies on the dollar per piece?
The sustainable industry is a very controversial topic, because there is no quote-unquote standard. What is the standard? So I'm not going to name the brand. A couple years ago, a brand calls me in and they say I needed to help me. They're an organic cotton recycled polyester company. Everything they make, and they sell it at Whole Foods, they sell it at Nordstrom's. I said, okay, where do you make the goods? China. But we work with an agent in Hong Kong. I said, okay, have you ever been to the factory? No. Do you have any transaction certificates proving that this is organic cotton? No. Okay. Now, I don't think these individuals had malintent. I don't think they're trying to deceive the customer. I go to the factory. I'd like to place an order. Can you please put this in organic cotton? It's going to be 50 cents more a pound, blah, 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 blah. You don't know what the hell you're getting. So if you truly, I'm on the board of Textile Exchange. If you really look from the farm to the mill, to the spinning, to blah, 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 all the way, you need to have certificates guaranteeing that. Now, the question is, you know, price. If you do a survey, this is the worst thing you could do, is whenever someone talks about the viability of Made in America or sustainability, they always say, when you survey people, they say customers are willing to pay more for sustainable products, or people would prefer sustainable products. You surveyed America, everyone said they were voting for Hillary. You know, people don't tell the truth, because when the decision comes that this is $7.99 and this is $12.99 and it's the exact same white T-shirt, what are you going to do? I don't know. I mean, you're being honest. You're probably going to buy this because what is it? It's not going inside my body. I'm not wiping my baby's tush with it. It's not, you know what I mean? It's not, you know, these companies that have, you know, it's not organic food, organic baby products, or maybe organic clothing people get a little bit sensitive about. A lot of people buy that as gifts, so they're not actually spending the money on their babies. But I think that companies are starting to realize, especially if you spoke to companies in Europe, that consumers are becoming more interested in sustainable fashion. There's a lot of, you know, anti-fast fashion, you know, this concept of just throwing things away. And Zara and H&M has a conscious collection. All these stores are doing it. And it's really not that much more expensive. But I guess the people aren't really gravitating towards that. But it's funny is, we think, oh, isn't it a horrible thing to have disposable fashion? Well, a guy stood up at this conference 2 weeks ago and said, my daughter will go to the Kylie and Jenner or whatever app and buy something. Basically, he was saying that they refuse. He's got a teenage daughter. They can't be in the same Instagram picture twice with the same outfit. They can't do that. So they have to keep buying this shit because they got to be, you know, everyone's a celebrity these days. I almost wore that suit that I had in the first picture. Oh, no. So I think that the way for sustainable fashion to work is the industry has to find a way to make the product at the same price, and it needs to just be that we all say we're going to make things more sustainable because it's good for the environment, it's good for humanity, and we're going to price it at the same way. I think we're far away from that. And there are niche brands, Everlane, and there are people out there that exist. Again, there's plenty of small companies that are doing very well. But I don't think that, again, tomorrow Hudson Bay is going to replace their entire floor with organic cotton because it's just not sustainable, no pun intended. Any other questions? Yes, all the way in the corner.
So I don't really agree with you, sorry, because I really care about the environment and I also care about the people who work in these factories. And I think of Patagonia when I think of a company that's done that very well. And I look for those places. I mean, I'm looking for those places and I seem to be circulating in different groups of people, I guess, because the people I circulate with do care about those things. They care about the dyes that are used in these factories that are harmful. And when you look at social media, this stuff is out there. People are looking at this stuff. So I don't agree that there isn't a market for
Absolutely.
Sustainable and kind of product that's fair to the employees that work in these factories. I care about that.
It is absolutely, there's a business out there. But the numbers don't lie. The amount of volume that Patagonia does versus the amount of volume that TJ Maxx does versus the amount of volume that Walmart does versus the amount of volume that name any other brand. They've built a loyal following because that is their ethos. That is their DNA. And there's people that buy into that. And it's more expensive product and there's more transparency through the supply chain. I'm not saying that there aren't, I just said before, there are Everlane and these companies are coming out that are catering to this market, but there's far fewer people that have your philosophy out there. You know, if that was the case, everything would be sustainable. Everything would be organic.
But it's growing. I mean, I worked in a retailer for a number of years that sold organic cotton, and I know what organic cotton is like. I know how much pesticide goes into one t-shirt. 1/3 of a pound of pesticide goes into a cotton t-shirt if it's not organic. And there's a lot of things to say about that. And I think that's growing. I mean, the organic industry is growing as far as food goes, and people are starting to look at these other issues as well. So I don't think that it's a matter that you can't do it. It's a matter that people don't know can be done.
I think we're...
Yeah, go ahead.
No, I mean, I think we're saying a lot of the same things. I don't disagree that there's viable businesses out there, but the numbers don't lie. I mean, how do you dispute the fact that the majority of the clothes made today are not sustainable, that we're in a deflationary market, prices keep going down, that consumers want to pay less and less? If the sentiment is the millennials want to wear a different outfit every time they put themselves on Instagram, I mean, that's a far cry from what you're preaching. And I don't think one's right or wrong. It's just the reality of the world we live in.